Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of 6 Bits a Day by Elmer Kelton. Narrated by George Guidall. This book is copyrighted 2004 by Elmer Kelton. This recording is copyrighted 2008 by Recorded Books. This is a novel of Hewey Calloway's younger years. As he and his beloved brother, Walter, leave the family farm in 1889 to find work in the West Texas cow country. And now, 6 Bits a Day.
Chapter 1. Hewey Calloway's stomach growled like an angry bear. He hadn't been so hungry in all his 22 years. Yesterday, he and his year younger brother, Walter, had eaten their last chunk of hog belly. It was so fat that he had had to force it down. Now, he would trade almost anything he owned for another piece of it, not that he owned much. Everything he had was either on his back or tied to his saddle. Walter had been riding in moody silence. He pulled up beside Hewey after passing around the far side of a mesquite whose thorns threatened to reach out and grab him. He said, "Even the trees here try to tear off a strip of hide. How far do you reckon we've traveled?" Hewey grunted, "A good ways." He wanted to keep a cheerful face, even if doubts were weighing on him. Walter said, "We ain't seen a human being in 2 days, and no game bigger than a jackrabbit. My belly is flatter than a stove lid." "Mine ain't no better." There had been a few jackrabbits, and Hewey had shot at them with an old wooden-handled six-shooter he carried in his saddlebags. But he was no marksman. Each bullet kicked up dirt several feet from the target and set the rabbit into startled flight. Walter said, "Some cowboys we are. I ain't got a pistol, and you'd just as well have left yours behind. I never saw such a poor shot." Hewey tried not to appear testy. "Had you rather be chopping cotton and slopping hogs? That's all we'd have if we went back to East Texas. Maybe we'd have a job and something to eat." Hewey saw one saving grace. "At least we're a long ways west of the cotton fields, and it's been a week since we've seen a hog." The 1880s were nearing an end, and most Texas land still open for new settlement was in the semi-arid western region beyond the Conchos. Short, sparse grass shared ground with desert plants such as greasewood and mesquite, and a dozen kinds of thorny cactuses that lay in ambush for the careless or the unlucky. Hewey and Walter's mother had died when they were boys. Over the next few years, their restless father had led them in a fruitless circle from the East Texas black lands to Oklahoma and Kansas, searching for an ideal home he would see only in his dreams. After his death, the brothers had wandered about, laboring at whatever they could find to ward off the wolves that had been at the Calloway door as far back as Hewey could remember. They struggled through a numbing variety of pick-and-shovel jobs before joining a trail outfit driving cattle to the Kansas Railroad. Horseback work had fitted Hewey like kid gloves. Now, however, the trails north were mostly closed. Farms and barbed wire had blocked them off. Long cattle drives were being rendered unnecessary by the extension of railroads across Texas. He had heard that large ranches were building up west of the farming country and needed men willing to work. He had no objection to work if he could do it in the saddle. Unlike Walter, he had never been able to fit his hands properly around a plow handle. "Our luck is bound to change," he said. He usually accepted the vagaries of life without getting his underwear in a twist. "We'll find work out here, somewhere." Walter preferred a sparrow on the hand to a hawk on the wing. "If we don't starve to death first, I can imagine somebody finding us 5 or 10 years from now, two little dried-up husks laying out on the prairie, kind of like a pair of old corn cobs with the shuck still on. The coyotes would chew us up long before that." Hewey toyed with the mental image. "I wish a coyote would show hisself. I'd eat him before he could eat me." "Not if you had to shoot him." The brothers had set out on this trip 3 weeks ago with hope and youthful high spirits. Like Pa, Hewey fantasized about the far hills and what might lie beyond. He envisioned a horseback life of freedom and adventure, excitement and glory. The trouble was that he was more than 10 years too late to share the fighting against Comanches and Kiowas, and the buffalo were gone. Most of the famous outlaws were dead, too, like Billy the Kid and Sam Bass and Jesse James. So far as he could see, the cowboy life was about all that remained to him. He meant to carve out a piece of it somewhere in western Texas. Walter did not share Huey's longing for adventure. He was comfortable with what he could see and hear and touch. He would be content with a solid job where pay and meals came regularly, where tomorrow was no more of a mystery than yesterday. Huey enjoyed reading blood-stirring novels about cowboys and pirates and knights of old. Walter found satisfaction in guiding a plow and keeping a straight row. He would have been happy to spend his life as a farmer somewhere back in the Blacklands. In Huey's view, East Texas had been cottoned out. It offered no future that interested him, while West Texas promised a fresh beginning. But his shining hopes had gradually diminished along with the supplies he and Walter had brought on the trip. At the moment, he would trade a month of tomorrow's for a plate of beans. Walter said, "Neither one of us would make a meal for a coyote. Even the buzzards don't pay us any mind." They had come across an occasional scattering of cattle, which usually hoisted their tails and clattered off into the nearest thicket. Huey grasped at the tattered shreds of his optimism. "Where there's cows, there's bound to be a ranch, and where there's a ranch, they're bound to need cowboys." The animals were of all colors and ran more to horn than to flesh. Huey said, "Takes a tough breed to make it in this western country." "You sure we're tough enough?" Huey set his jaw. "Our name's Calloway, ain't it? Pa carried a Yankee bullet in him for 20 years, right up to the day he died. We just got to take another hitch in our belts." He would have to punch a new hole to make his any tighter. Sundown came with no sign of a dwelling or watering place. But at dusk, Huey saw the flicker of a campfire. Walter said, "Maybe they'll give us something to eat." Huey said, "We ain't gonna ride in there and beg. Us Calloways have never begged for nothing." Walter said, "Maybe they'll hear our stomachs growl." Huey assumed the lead, as he usually did, being a year or so older. He put his horse into an easy lope and didn't slow until he was within rock-throwing distance of the fire. He saw nobody. A stern voice spoke from behind a bush, "You'll lift them hands to where I can see them." Huey didn't spot the man at first, or the gun, but his gut told him they were there in the dusk. "Friend," he said shakily, "we ain't out for no trouble." A tall, lanky man walked into the open, holding a pistol. He said, "You must be pilgrims or you'd know not to charge into a camp like that. You always holler first, find out if you're welcome." A shiny badge reflected firelight. Law officers made Huey uneasy. Back where they came from, he had had a couple of run-ins with old Sheriff Noonan, a man with a stern commitment to the letter of the law. There was, for instance, the time Huey had slipped over to old man Babcock's farm one night and whacked off all the pigs' tails. A pen full of bob-tailed pigs looked funny to Huey, but Babcock and the sheriff had not seen the humor in it. The jail cot was the hardest bed Huey had ever tried to sleep on. He said, "Don't shoot, mister. We'll ride on and not bother you no more." Moving closer, the man gave each brother a moment's study, then slipped the pistol back into a holster on his hip. The frown slowly left his thin face. "I had to be certain of your intentions. Name's Len Tanner."
"Ours is Calloway. I'm Huey, and he's Walter. Pleased to make your acquaintance."
Huey kept looking at the badge. It was circular with a star in the center.
"You a sheriff?"
"Texas Ranger." Tanner touched his forefinger to the badge. "Pretty, ain't it? Had it made out of a Mexican peso." Huey judged that Tanner was well into middle age. Firelight exaggerated the facial creases and the roughness of a skin weathered by sun and wind. It crossed Hughie's mind that a ranger must lead an exciting life, maybe better even than a cowboy's. But he didn't dwell on the notion long, for he knew he was too poor a marksman to be accepted into such a demanding organization. He couldn't hit a barn from the inside. The campfire drew his attention. A small coffee pot sat on the coals. A half-cooked slice of beef lay in a skillet on the ground. Tanner had probably set it off to one side when he heard the horses coming. Hughie said, "I'd trade you a good pocket knife for some of that." Tanner shook his head. "Already got a knife." Seeing Hughie's disappointment, he added, "But you're welcome to share my supper. Didn't cost me nothing anyway. It's contraband." "Contraband?" Hughie thought that was some kind of illegal whiskey. "I was trailing a pair of thieves that butchered another man's beef. They ran off and left the meat behind." "You didn't catch them?" "I know where they'll light. Most criminals ain't weighted down with brains." He fetched a tin cup out of a canvas bag and tapped it on his knee to dislodge a scorpion or anything else that might be in it. He handed it to Hughie. "Help yourselves to the coffee. I'll heat the skillet again." Hughie filled the cup. The rim burned his lips. He handed the cup to Walter. "Hot. Needs to be blowed a little." Hughie had no compunctions about sharing a cup. He was used to drinking from cisterns and wells that had a community cup for use by anyone who came along. He said, "I remember a story about some yahoo that dragged into town starving to death for water. They asked him why he didn't drink at one of the wells he passed along the way, and he said, 'I couldn't. I had no cup.'" Tanner chuckled at the story and told a couple of his own while he waited for the steaks to get done. He watched, bemused, as Hughie and Walter wolfed down the meat, which was sizzling hot from the skillet. "Sorry I got no gravy." He fried a second helping, then sat back while the brothers finished that, too. He asked, "How long since you boys left the cotton patch?" Hughie said, "Does it show? You've both got lint in your ears. What brings you out so far from water? There ain't a decent farm in 100 miles. Hughie said, "That's the way we want it. We're looking for cowboy work." Tanner grunted. "Cowboy life ain't exactly like the storybooks tell it. You're up before daylight and out till dark. You sweat for 30 days to earn a piddling wage that you can blow in 30 minutes. Walter asked, "Does rangering pay better?" "Not always, but a ranger don't have to put up with a bunch of bawling cows. Ain't nothing dumber than a cow unless it's a sheep." Hughie said, "We know. We've done some cow work ourselves." Tanner responded, "A horse is a little smarter, but not much. I've been throwed off and stomped on more times than I've ever been shot at, even being a ranger." Hughie nodded. "I notice you've got to look quick if you want to see these cattle around here. They're up and gone before you can say scat. They ain't house broke. Some'll run you ragged, then try to put a horn through your gizzard. But if you're bound and determined to chase cows, good luck to you. I'd do better chasing outlaws." Hughie's imagination ran free as he pictured the adventures this lawman might have experienced. "How long you been a ranger?"
"I started in the Indian times, before the big war. Wasn't much more than a skinny button then."
He was still skinny, Hughie thought, but long past being a button. The talkative Tanner related stories about chasing and being chased by Comanches, and about long searches for criminals of every stripe. He said, "For a while of late I was down in the Rio Grande, chasing after border jumpers from both sides of the river. Big state, Texas, is, and I've crossed every river in it just about. Got the scars to prove it." He rolled up his sleeve to show a raised mark about 5 inches long. "That's one of the littlest. A knife blade done that." Hughie chilled at the thought of cold steel. Tanner asked, "Ever hear of Rusty Shining and Andy Pickard?" Hughie had not. Tanner said, "Good men, both of them. Me and them rode many a mile together. They're out of the Rangers now. Old Rusty's married and got 2 young'uns. Andy took him a pretty young wife, too." Hughie asked, "You ever been married?" "Nah, horses and dogs like me, but I don't shine in the women folks' eyes. The Lord didn't choose to make me handsome. He just made me lucky instead." After breakfast, Tanner gave the brothers most of the meat that remained. He ignored their polite objections. He said, "It don't take much for a skinny old hull like me. You two need it to keep your strength up in this big dry country." Hewey regretted parting company with the ranger, but Tanner was headed southward. Watching him ride away, Walter said, "He's a great talker. You reckon half of what he told us really happened?" "If it didn't, it ought to have." Hewey touched spurs to his horse and started west. "We ain't finding work setting here." At the middle of the afternoon, he saw dust ahead, stirred by a herd of cattle. "Maybe somebody can point us to a job of work." He moved his horse into a lope. He was halfway there before Walter caught up with him. Two horsemen appeared from within a clump of mesquite brush, brandishing pistols. A scowling rider with 2 weeks' growth of mottled whiskers demanded, "Who are you, and what's your business here?" Staring into two formidable-looking muzzles, Hewey felt a chill. He had never been drawn to guns. He stammered, "Nothing. We don't even rightly know where we're at." The man's belligerence slowly subsided. "You all ain't nothing but a pair of punkin' rollers. We thought you might be cattle rustlers. In this country, we gotta be careful." He holstered the pistol and gave a silent signal to his younger partner to do the same. The second man hadn't used a razor in a while either, but his stubble was more like fuzz than whiskers. "Just looking over the country, are you?" Huey's voice steadied. "What we're really looking for is a job." "Cowboys, are you? We've been up the trail once." The man considered for a minute. "Me and Chum here could use a little help. How about 6 bits a day and found?" "Found? Grub and all the ground you need to roll out your bed." 6 bits wasn't much, Hewey thought, but it beat what they'd been doing. The thought of regular grub made up for a lot. "Just tell us what you want done. Fall in behind them cows and help us keep them moving. Me and Chum ain't been making good time by ourselves." Hewey said, "We can do that." He started to ride up, but paused. "What do we call you, mister?" "Call me Mr. Smith." "You don't have to mister, my partner. Just call him Chum." Hewey rough counted about 100 cows in this bunch, and most had calves. He couldn't see that driving them offered much challenge. They appeared to have been driven far and hard already. Heads down, they drooled and dragged their feet. Many calves had fallen to the dusty rear, unable to keep up with their mothers. Cows kept stopping and turning back, bawling for their offspring. The smell of their saliva and fresh warm manure was strong in Huey's nostrils. Smith and Chum left Hewey and Walter in the dust and took positions farther ahead. After a while, Smith turned back, agitated. "You're letting the drag fall behind. Punch them up." Hewey said, "These calves ain't got much left in them to punch. How much farther do they have to go?" The answer was curt. "I'll let you know when we get there. Keep pushing." Walter rode over beside Hewey. "He's going to walk the hooves plumb off of them." Hewey shrugged. "They're his, so it's none of our worry as long as we get paid." Nevertheless, he disliked seeing animals punished, especially small calves. "I don't see where it'd make much difference if it took a little longer. Cows don't know what time it is." He noticed that most of the cows were branded CC and earmarked with a swallow fork. Several bore a J-bar brand and a different mark. Walter started to speak. "You don't suppose..." He broke off in mid-sentence. "No, they wouldn't be." "Be what?" Hewey asked. "Nothing. I don't know why I said anything." Hewey puzzled over what Walter might have been thinking, but he didn't dwell on it long. "We've got what we came for, a paying job that'll feed us." Smith didn't stop the drive until after sundown. Chum built a small fire to boil coffee and fry just enough bacon to neutralize the hunger pangs. He took the bacon away from the heat while it was a little raw. "We got to put this fire out. They can see it for a long ways in the dark." Hewey knew it was best not to question the boss, but he asked anyway. "Who is they?" Smith said, "Indians." "I thought all the Indians were on the reservation." "Never can tell when some of them bucks may bust out. A herd like this would be easy pickings." Hewey thought Smith was overcautious. It had been years since he had heard of any Indian trouble. "All the Indians I ever saw was tame ones." Smith studied their back trail, his eyes narrowed. You boys are too young to remember the old days. Once you've heard a war whoop, you never forget it. Hewey looked in all directions. I don't see anything. It's when you don't see anything that you'd better be extra careful. Hewey hoped Smith would tell about some of his adventures with Indians, but unlike Tanner, he was not a talker. He held his cards close to the vest. As he poured a second cup of coffee, he said, You boys take the first watch. Me and Chum will relieve you after midnight. The cattle were so leg-weary that they bedded down easily once the cows and calves had paired up. Hewey saw little danger that they would stampede in the night. The moon was full. He rode a slow circle around the herd and met Walter coming from the other direction. Walter said, I ain't heard you singing to them. With my voice, they'd jump and run. Yeah, I've heard you in church. You ain't no nightingale. Pa had taught Hewey how to tell time in a general way by the position of the stars as they made a slow circle in the night sky. He judged it was considerably past midnight when Smith rode up to him and asked, See or hear anything? Nothing but a cow at the croup. No Indians. There's other things to worry about besides Indians. It'd be a shame if cattle rustlers was to take this herd before we can get it to the ranch. Where's that? Other side of the Rio Grande. Smith jerked his head in a southward direction. Better get a little sleep. We'll be driving them hard again tomorrow. The pace is tough on the calves. Smith's voice was sharp. I'll worry about the stock. You just do what I hired you for. Hewey shrugged. Though he felt sorry for the cattle, it was none of his business if the boss worked them down to hide and bone. It just didn't seem logical for an owner to mistreat his property. This herd was worth money. He met Walter before reaching camp. Hewey said, I could use a cup of coffee. Walter said, Chum told me not to start that fire again. He's worried about cow thieves seeing it. No self-respecting cattle thief would be out stirring around at this time of the night, Hewey said. But orders were orders, and they hadn't earned but 6 bits apiece so far. In the dark, Hewey had a hard time finding a place smooth enough to spread his blanket. Something kept poking him in the back. He finally got sleepy enough to ignore it. By the time he came fully awake, the sun was rising. He saw that Walter was sitting up listening. Walter said, I hear horses running. Hewey flung the blanket aside and stood up. He saw two horsemen moving south in a long lope, leaving the herd behind. That's Smith and Chum, he said. Must be chasing a runaway cow. Looks more like they're being chased. Walter pointed to horsemen approaching rapidly from the north. 4 men split off in pursuit of Smith and Chum, 4 others came toward the herd. Hewey felt sudden apprehension. They may be the cattle thieves Smith was worried about. Walter's expression was grave. Or maybe the real thieves are them 2 we hired on with. Hewey's eyes widened as the suggestion soaked in. You think we've been driving stolen cattle? It crossed my mind. Then we're in a mess of trouble. Hewey expelled a long breath. I wish you'd told me what you was thinking. You're the oldest. You're supposed to be the smartest. I ought to have suspicioned them myself. I was just too anxious about getting a job and something to eat. Walter's voice was shaky. Those people look pretty mad. Just try to appear innocent, like we don't know nothing. That ought to come natural. The 4 riders seemed to bristle with guns. Hewey assumed the oldest was the leader. He was a smallish, skinny man of middle age or perhaps a little past. It was hard to tell through several days' growth of whiskers. He pointed a pistol that appeared, from Hewey's angle, to be larger than he was. The man wore a dusty, misshapen old felt hat with deep grease stains and a wide brim tattered along its edges. He looked as if he might have crawled out from under a freight car. He gave Hewey and Walter a blistering look and declared, Thought you got my cows cheap, did you? 2 C's beef comes awful high. A young man with a round, chubby face grinned with anticipation. Let's hang them, Mr. Tarpley. Tarpley's reply was curt. Use your head. There ain't a tree around here big enough to hang a man on. Just thought it'd be a good lesson to them.
In the old days, we could take thieves like these and give their necks a stretching without having to go to the courthouse. Now, it'd stir up a narrow-minded sheriff and a dozen swivel-jawed lawyers.
Hewey struggled for voice. We ain't thieves. We caught you red-handed with my cows. I'd call that thieving. But we didn't know they were stolen. Me and Walter, we just hired out yesterday. The man said they was his.
What man was that? What was his name?
Smith.
We seen two run off. Who was the other one?
The only name we heard was Chum.
Tarpley snorted. Smith. I reckon you all are named Jones?
No, sir. I'm Hewey Calloway, and this is my brother Walter. We just come from over in East Texas.
The chubby boy said, If we can't hang them, can we shoot them?
Tarpley snapped. Shut up, fat.
Another cowboy put in,
I kind of believe them, C.C. They look too green to be cow thieves, probably a couple of farm boys fresh off of the plow.
What would you know about farm boys, Grady Welch?
I was one myself, greener than a gourd vine when I came out here. I was a lot like these two.
Tarpley seemed to give at least some consideration to what this cowboy said. We'll have to let the sheriff sort it all out. He looked back at Hewey. You boys got any guns? Hewey pointed to his saddle lying on the ground.
Walter don't. I got a six-shooter in my saddlebags, but I can't hit anything with it.
Damn few cowboys can. Fat, go fetch it to me. Then you boys saddle up. You're going to help us drive these cows and calves back to where they come from.
Hewey thought about asking him if they would be paid for the work, but Tarpley did not appear in a mood to discuss wages.
The four riders who had pursued Smith and Chum returned, empty-handed. Sorry, C.C., one said, but their horses was faster than ours. One of them was that half-thoroughbred you used to match races with.
Tarpley scowled. Ain't but one thing lower than a cow thief, and that's a man that is still your best horse.
He jerked his head as a signal.
Let's take them cows home.
Chapter 2
Tarpley grumbled about the condition of the cattle. They're drawed pretty bad. You boys been running them, looks like.
Hewey said. I told Mr. Smith we was pushing them too hard. He said he was afraid cattle rustlers might catch up to us.
Wasn't rustlers he was afraid of. It was me. There was a time when cow thieves shivered at the name of C.C. Tarpley. They ain't forgot my reputation. I'm surprised you didn't recognize my brand.
Like I told you, me and Walter are strangers here. We just hired out yesterday.
I got to have more than your word about that.
Hewey watched, puzzled, as Tarpley moved away.
The rancher hardly fitted his vision of a big, important cowman. Instead of boots, he wore a pair of old lace-up shoes crusted with dirt. His saddle could have been a veteran of the first drive up the Chisholm Trail, and his clothes looked as if they might have been cast off by some passing tramp.
The cowboy named Grady pulled up beside Hewey. He sat in his saddle with the ease of a man who knew his way around a horse. Though he wore a loose shirt with a ripped sleeve clumsily repaired, his broad-brimmed felt hat was carefully shaped. His boots appeared to be custom-made. His leather chaps bore silver conchas, which hadn't come cheaply, and inlaid silver hearts decorated his spurs. In contrast to Tarpley, he looked as if he were trying to live up to an image shaped by the penny dreadful magazines. Hewey said, Mr. Tarpley don't look like a cattle baron to me. I'd expect to see him swamping out a saloon.
Grady smiled.
He may not look like much, but when he shows up at the bank, they call out a brass band.
He rolled and lighted a cigarette and offered the sack to Hewey.
What part of East Texas are you boys from?
Nervous, Hewey spilled more tobacco than went onto the paper. He passed the sack back to Grady without offering it to Walter. He was trying to shield his kid brother from bad habits.
Our pa sharecropped over in the Blacklands.
I'm from the Piney Woods myself. Came out here 4 years ago.
Been a cowboy all that time?
That's about all there is to do unless you want to herd sheep. That's left mostly to the Mexicans.
Tarpley hollered. Grady, I wouldn't get too sociable with them boys. They're liable to contaminate you.
They've got honest faces.
So did Billy the Kid.
The cattle were allowed to set their own slow pace, grazing as they went. By late afternoon, Hewey guessed they had not traveled more than 5 or 6 miles. They came to a large pool where runoff from a recent rain had gathered in a depression.
The cows and calves picked up the pace as they smelled the water. They eagerly crowded into it, some standing belly-deep while they drank. Hewey was feeling dry himself. He wasn't sure he wanted a drink where the mud had been stirred, but he changed his mind when he saw Grady kneel and scoop up water in his cupped hands where no cattle or horses had been. Grady said, "I'm thinking about growing me a mustache to serve as a strainer." Hewey tried to do as Grady did. After a couple of tries, he managed to hold enough water in his hands that he could get a decent mouthful. As he expected, it tasted of mud. Grady said, "This beats drinking out of a cow track. Done that a few times." Hewey looked back toward C.C. Tarpley. "Ain't you afraid I'll contaminate you?" Grady smiled. "C.C. barks loud, but he ain't got any teeth, hardly. He's a damn good cowman, even if he has got the soul of an old pirate." "Pirate?" "He's big, and intends to get bigger no matter what it takes. He's a dried-up, skinny little feller, but he's tied together with rawhide." Hewey grimaced. That did not bode well for him and Walter. Tarpley decided to make camp so the cattle could water again when they wanted to. He didn't feed much better than Smith had. Pursuit of the cattle thieves had been undertaken too quickly to allow for much preparation. Somebody had thrown a bag of Arbuckle's coffee and a smoked ham into a canvas sack. That had been dinner. Now it was supper, and it would be tomorrow's breakfast if it lasted that long. In the pressure of the moment, no one had thought to pick up the little food that had remained in Smith's camp. That had probably become some coyote supper by now. Hewey noted that everybody in the outfit was on the lean side except for the one called Fat. It occurred to him that cowboy life might not be the best choice for somebody who loved to eat. Grady warmed a slice of smoked ham on a stick, holding it over a small fire. He offered it to Hewey, who cut off half and handed the rest back. He said, "I think a cow outfit would be eating beef." Grady said, "Only if it's a stray. C.C. thinks too much of his cattle to eat them." Fat glared at Grady. "It ain't right to feed them cow thieves when the rest of us ain't got enough." Grady retorted, "A wagon load of groceries wouldn't be enough for you, Fat." Fat said something under his breath and stalked away. Grady said in a low voice, "Don't pay no attention to Fat Girvin. He was born on the wrong side of the bed and been getting up that way ever since. At least he's got a job. The only place he makes a hand is at the table. I think C.C. keeps him on just so he's got somebody to holler at that's afraid to holler back. Right now, Mr. Tarpley scares me a little, too." "Don't let him. He's stubborn as a mule and tight as the bark on a tree, but you never saw anybody gentler when it comes to his livestock. He don't wear spurs because he don't want to hurt a horse. He won't hardly even cuss a cow, not out loud." A hawk soared overhead and screamed a warning as the riders approached its nest. Hewey envied the bird. He wished he had its wings and could simply fly away from here. "I don't know what he's liable to do to me and Walter." "I wouldn't worry too much. They don't hang cow thieves anymore. For a first offense, they just send them up for 5 to 10 years. Grady made a thin smile, but his comment sounded too much like the truth to be funny. Toward noon the next day, Hewey saw a couple of windmills ahead, towering over the scrub mesquite and greasewood. Beyond lay a long, flat-topped desert mountain. Grady said, "We're coming to the ranch headquarters." Fat Girvin drew in close, smiling wickedly at Hewey and Walter. "We're short of trees, but we could hang them inside a windmill tower." Grady said, "Don't bedevil the boys, Fat." Girvin's face flushed. "You know I don't like anybody to call me that. My name is Frank."
"C.C. calls you Fat."
"Mr. Tarpley ain't just anybody. He's the one that pays me."
"I'll try to remember that. Fat."
Tarpley rode back from the point of the herd. "We'll turn them loose on the water and let them scatter on their own. First, though, there's a few Jessup cows in the bunch. We'll cut them out." He did the cutting himself. The rancher quietly worked his horse in and out of the herd with an ease that came from long years' experience. Grady had lauded Tarpley's abilities as a cowman. Hewey could see what he meant. Tarpley removed about a dozen cows from the herd. They bore a J-bar brand. Several had calves not yet branded. He said,
Shorty, you and Baker drive them back onto Eli Jessup's land, way back. Be damned if I'll let that old land hog fatten his cows on my grass.
Hewey said, doesn't sound like he's got much use for this fellow Jessup.
Grady replied, he'd ride bareback 100 miles to attend old Eli's funeral.
A spotted dog came trotting out to meet the horseman. It barked a welcome, then trotted alongside Tarpley's horse, escorting his owner in. The headquarters was utilitarian. The only natural trees were a few large granddaddy mesquites with thick, gnarly trunks shielded by dry, rough bark. Evidently no one had taken time or trouble to plant domestic varieties. Hewey counted 3 frame structures, unpainted, but not yet old enough to have turned the gray of weathered lumber. One was obviously a barn. He assumed a long, narrow building to be a bunkhouse. A small, square one appeared to be a family residence. A woman and a girl stood on the narrow front porch, watching the rider's approach. Grady said,
that's C.C.'s wife and daughter.
It don't look like much of a house for an owner.
C.C. says there'll be time to build a big house when he's got enough land and cows to suit him. With his ambition, that ain't likely to be soon. Jessup's ranch is bigger than his, and it plagues him like a case of hives.
Hewey noticed that Fat kept staring toward the house, probably at Tarpley's daughter. From here he would guess her to be 16 or so, just ripening. She was no great shakes for looks, however. The dog separated itself from the riders and moved into the shade of the Tarpley house. Tarpley's gaze lighted upon Hewey and Walter.
Over yonder is a dugout that I lived in when I first come here. It ain't got but one door. We'll put you boys in there till we can get the sheriff to come out.
He nodded at Grady.
Bar the door from the outside and keep watch on it. Fat'll relieve you after a while.
The pudgy cowboy turned red in the face at the use of his uncomplimentary nickname. Hewey had noticed that no one except Fat called the boss Mr. Tarpley. Everybody else said C.C. Grady jerked his head as a signal for Hewey and Walter to follow him. The dugout had been built into a low, gravelly bank. Its roof was of mesquite branches and bare grass clumps weighted down with dirt. The door was of rough lumber, dry and splitting. Grady opened it and looked inside.
He said, ain't exactly the Manger Hotel, but it's probably cooler than the bunkhouse. You might want to look it over to be sure you ain't got company. There's something about dugouts that just naturally draws rattlesnakes.
Dismounting, Hewey untied his blanket from behind the cantle of his saddle and paused at the door. The place smelled musty.
What about our horses? I'll take care of them, and I'll see to it that the cook feeds you after a while. Make yourselves to home.
Walter said, right now I wish we had a home.
Grady shooed a couple of chickens outside, then pushed the door shut. Hewey flinched at the sound of a wooden bar falling into place. The interior seemed gloomy and dark at first. As his eyes adjusted, he saw light streaming in from wide cracks in the door and holes in the roof where the dirt covering had thinned and either washed or blown away from the dry branches that supported it. He said,
kind of like being in jail.
Walter said, I wouldn't know, never been there.
I have, by invitation of Sheriff Noonan. The old reprobate always took things too serious.
Hewey looked up at the low roof. He could see blue sky in places.
A man could probably dig through there in a little while.
And then what? We're out in the middle of nowhere.
Every place is somewhere, and there's always some place to the west of it. Come dark, we could catch our horses and get
chased all the way to El Paso. I say we keep telling him what really happened.
Pa always said the truth will come out if you wait long enough. Like after 5 to 10 years in the pan?
You ought to be able to get some character references from back home.
Hewey shook his head.
Not from Sheriff Noonan. He's had it in for me ever since the night I took his paint horse from in front of the jailhouse and titled it Big Bessie's. Everybody in town knew that horse.
You never was one to think much about consequences.
Despite the gloomy situation, the memory made Hewey smile.
His wife wouldn't even speak to him.
Walter said, the truth finally came out. The truth will come out for me and you too. I always knew I might have to pay the fiddler when I pulled that stunt on old Noonan. But getting in this mess wasn't my fault.
I'm not blaming you for it.
Walter spread his blanket on the dirt floor and stretched out.
The fact is, I always wished I had a little of your recklessness. But every time I felt tempted, I stopped and thought about it first, and then I didn't do it.
Thinking too much spoils the fun.
Are you having fun now?
Hewey admitted, not much.
He looked up again at the roof and thought how easy it might be to dig out. Maybe after dark.
Sometime in the late afternoon he heard the bar slide away and the bottom of the door drag against the hard-packed earth. The bright light hurt his eyes. Grady Welch motioned for him and Walter to come out.
Supper's ready at the kitchen. C.C. says it's all right for you all to come down.
Hewey asked, and risk contaminating the crew? He's starting to
lean. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.